Welcome. My name is Darren Williams. I'm one of the pastors here at Cooper City Church of God, and I'm grateful that you can join in with us into our service on this morning. Wherever you're watching it from or how you're using it, using the electronic devices, I thank God for you to have this opportunity to share the good news and the Word of God this morning. Some of you could be watching this from YouTube or Facebook, or you can go to our online app, worshipathome.online. There you can get a chance to see other videos such as this and get the chance to hear God work throughout the week. Now, because we're here in the church, I'm here in the church and you're at home, the reason why is because of the fact the recent cases of the coronavirus. Our church has made an incredible decision to say, let's stay at home, let's play it safe. We opened up a couple of weeks ago and then we made the decision to close down. I commend our pastor and the staff for doing that because of the fact that, once again, the spikes in the coronavirus cases, it only makes sense. And I must say, looking at what the church has put together from the manual to the training to all the equipment they purchased to make sure that this church and sanctuary is clean and safe when that day come back for return. So I thank God for what they are doing. So I just want to encourage you, continue to watch us online through our online platform, and before you know it, we'll be back in church. Now today marks the first day of our 21 days of prayer. And in the season of prayer, our theme this month would be Heal Our Land. Now, throughout the course of this month, for 21 days, you're going to see myself and other individuals begin to pray through our video message. You can always go to our church app and look at the various videos as well as hear the message that each one of us have to encourage you during the video message. Now, healing our land also talks about healing us as individuals because so many of us have been affected by this coronavirus. Some are without jobs. Some are dealing with situations. And some have even have loved ones in the hospital, and it's very difficult right now to go see a loved one because hospital is keeping everybody out, only those that's patient. So if you have an opportunity to go to our website, we have resources there for you can actually download and take part in our 21 day of prayer because the information there on the site give you scriptures on healing as well as other scriptures that it fits your soul. This Sunday as well as the next three Sundays, myself and a couple other pastors and the prayer team will be here at the church between the hours of 8:30 and 12:30, and we're going to be outside handing out prayer 21 day prayer manuals. If you decide to come by, we're going to be able to give you one of these books, and also we're going to be able to pray for you if you need prayer. But you will have to stay in your car. We're going to continue to respect the CDC requirements of social distance, but we're going to be able to pray for you and encourage you, but also it gives us the opportunity to say hello to you. How about that? If you have your Bibles, I want you to, or you can download, we have a Bible app called YouVersion, or you can go to our Cooper City one, but this is a free app. You can go online to download it. It's great. If you have your regular Bible, please get ready because we're going to get into the Word of God. Or you can go to our Cooper City Church of God app, download it. It has a lot of information. As I stated earlier, it allows you to see not only this video, but other videos in this series and past series, but it also keeps you informed of what's going on at Cooper City. And one important thing I would say at the Cooper City app is groups. Be a part of being able to join a group because of the fact that if you're home, you're sitting up in the house for quite some time, it's going to be difficult and be boring. But just to be able to hear and talk to other friends, and we have this church community that we speak with each other on Zoom as well as Teams. So go to our app, download it, Bible reading, prayer points, online giving, and also, this material will be online. You could download it. And this book has a lot of information to help you in your prayer life. Last week, our series is going to be called The Full Armor of God. On last week, our Pastor Harris opened up a great introduction on the armor of God. He talked about each one of the particular items of a soldier he will wear, as Paul has spoken in Ephesians, the sixth chapter. Verses 10 through 18, and we're going to get ready to read that particular scripture if you go to Ephesians 6, starting at verse 10. But our pastor opened it up, and he gave a good summary of each one of them, how that those particular one would actually bless us and actually keep us and actually mold us as soldier. So I got the opportunity to speak on a topic of the belt of truth. And each week after this, there will be other ones speaking on different portions of the armor of God. But the concept or the main focus is putting on the full armor of God. If you got your Bible, I'm going to be starting at Ephesians, the 6th chapter, verses 10. And it says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his might, in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's scheme. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckle around your waist. And I highlight that because that's where I'm going to be talking about. With the breastplate of righteousness in place, and your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all of this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Praise God. So just to give you a background of exactly what was happening, our topic, once again, is going to be the belt of truth, as said. And what it is Paul is in prison. He's in Ephesus. And one thing about Paul, he wrote several letters to different churches while he was there. He wrote it for Philippians. He wrote it for Colossians. He wrote it for Ephesus. And he wrote it for an individual in Philemon. But Paul was in this prison. And sometimes some writing would say that he was shackled by two guards. Sitting in this prison cell, Paul began to look at the Roman soldier, and he began to look at his outfit and what he was wearing. And Paul began to pen the letter to the church of Ephesus and began to talk about the spiritual armor of God. And one of the first things he described was the belt of truth. And what is truth? And how does the truth actually, supports the rest of the armor of God? Now, let's take this, if you can imagine, as a soldier, being part of an army. One thing about a soldier is that he always want to be a part of an army that has a good leader, and definitely a leader that has a great strategy. I myself, you know, always like to follow great leadership. And just like you, things flow better when we have a great leadership. And the leadership from a spiritual standpoint is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He is our great commander. He is our leader. He is our king. And when you look at any war in that particular days, the king always rode into war. He was always part of the process. And the thing about it is that the king will always be in combat. He would never leave you out. He would never be left out of the combat. Now, before you can go to war, there are certain things has to take place. You have to make sure that you're ready. And then you got to make sure also that it is the position that you're going to be placed in is best suited for you. So the belt of truth, when I look at it, is that we have to understand, one, from a strategy point of view, do we have a great leader? And does that leader have a strategy? Well, my belief is that we do. By serving Christ, we have an awesome leader. And I want to question you, why battle? There are certain things that we in this battle for, and each one of us have a different battle. I would tell you this, and when I go to the battle, Ephesians 6 and 12, which we already stated, if we go back and look at it, it says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, meaning that we're not battling the flesh and blood. A lot of times that we have disagreements or we have situations that arise, we must look at it from a spiritual sense. But against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil and heavenly realms. Yes, there's going to be times when people will say things and come against you and plot against you. But you got to remember, as a child of God, you're walking in a spiritual battle. You have to not allow their flesh, they're not allow the things that they throw at you, these fiery darts. But you got to gird yourself and understand that God's going to give you the victory no matter how the situation is. 2 Corinthians verses 10 through 5, it says, "For though we live in this world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds," pulling down strongholds. "We demolish arguments and every pretense that set itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captivity every thought to make it obedient to Christ." Just hearing that, I understand the battle. I'm in a spiritual battle. I'm not in a natural battle. I have to look at it from a different lens. I got to understand that no matter how the situation look, I am serving a true God. In this battle, we're going to come to understand that once we establish who Christ is to us as a king, as a leader, as a newborn babe, somebody converted over to become a child of God, we begin to understand the victory that's already placed in us. Listen, truth is, we have already won the battle through the life of Christ. See, many years ago, Christ died on the cross for us. He won the battle over death. He won the battle over the grave. We're still here, and we have some battles that we got to fight against. However, he's the king. He's there with us. And one of the things about it, he's empowering us to overcome these issues or these battles. Now, the first point I want to discuss out of the three points is confidence in the truth, having a secure foundation. As stated before, having Christ as our centerpiece, we have to have a foundation. I have established in my strong leader. So as a new soldier part of this new platoon, I am now looking at this new commander, and I'm learning about him. But for the truth of the matter, John 1 and 14 say, "And the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." I'm getting a resume. I'm getting some information about who the person I'm serving. I have to establish that relationship with him. John 14 and 6 and say, Jesus say, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." John 16 and 13 comes back and say, "But when he, the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of God, is among the camp, is among the individuals that's going to help train you and build you up and build your confidence so you can stand and hear the voice of God. So in a time of battle, you're not listening to other naysayers or other people's statements or philosophies. But when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak of his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will also speak and begin to tell you about who Christ is. Each one of us has to have a personal relationship with Christ. We're going to understand, and what I'm talking about is that once I establish my foundation, my understanding that I'm following Christ, my new walk is through him. And as I begin to follow him, certain things are going to be revealed, and he's going to be able to show me. But one thing he will do is make sure that I'm ready for the battle. I would go through certain situations. If I don't do well in these situations, I will have to come back. But he's going to make sure that I'm ready for a time that come. And so how I go through the battle is going to be how I get blessed on the opposite end of it. Ephesians 4, 14 to 24, where 14, starting in verse 24, I say, "Then we will no longer be infants, tossed to and fro by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning of craftiness of people in their deceitful schemes. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ, our leader. From him the whole body has come together, joined by, held together by every supporting ligament, grown and built itself up in love as each part does its work." Now, the belt. The belt was, like I said, was one of the first things that Paul described. The belt holds the entire armor together. Without the belt, things shake, things move, there's no connection. The belt holds the sword, it holds tools, it holds ration or food, but like I said before, it holds the armor together. And any portion of that belt that's twisted a certain way, the soldier couldn't maneuver right because his armor was loose, and you have to secure the belt. And so the foundation and importance of having that belt in place to hold the armor. Now, also in those days, those belts were actually designed to have leather that came down, and actually when he was in battle, sometimes they would swipe at his legs, and the leather would actually protect the belt of the leather off the belt would actually protect the person. In this case, this belt not only holds, it protects, and some would take their tunic or their robe and fold it back so they have room to maneuver. It gave freedom. So the belt did a lot of things, but one thing about the belt I want to keep emphasized, it was the foundation to the entire gear. It held things together. Going back onto that verse, it says, jointed and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. John 17:17 reads, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. Those particular scriptures that I just finished reading, when it comes to securing the foundation, I understand who my leader is. I heard about him. I read about him. I am entrusting him. He's not going to put me in harm's way. He's always going to put me in an opportunity where I'm going to be blessed. But I myself have to build my skills up. I myself have to know how this belt works, how I can secure and hold things together. He's training me, he's developing me, same as you. Sometimes we go for a long period of time through these trials and tribulations, you might say, or I call them challenges. But the whole concept is that you're getting practice, the little small things. So when the situation comes up, you're not to handle yourself in these particular battles. Now, the second thing that we need to keep in mind is the right fit, personal, the right fit. It's important that we understand the right fit because of the fact that this is personal. Everybody has a different height as well as size. A small belt doesn't work on everybody, and a large belt doesn't work on everybody. After I understand who I serve, after I understand how important it is to secure the belt that I can secure all of my gear, I got to make sure that belt fits. See, the truth is that the belt of truth has to fit for me personally. Each one of y'all have a different, battle. Everybody has a different battle. And in that process of the battle is that at different stages of our life we experience, we go through different times, and my battle might be different from your battle at this time, but we're going to learn that we all come together. So the belt has to fit. It has to buckle. It has to strap down and support everything. Here's a story in 1 Samuel 17:38-39. I love this story because of the fact that this is David. David is the young warrior at this time. He's unknown, but there is a Philistine giant. They call him Goliath. He's a champion. He's a warrior. The Bible goes on and talks about the description of his armor and his spear. And he threatened and he called and he said all kinds of defiled names against the children of Israel, or the army of God. And he challenged them for whoever they can come out and bring their champion to fight him. He's the champion. The army saw as the king. Everybody stood back, but here's David. He happened to come by. And he heard the statement, but David saw it like Paul saw it. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. He's not seeing this as a natural battle, but he saw it as a spiritual battle. David stood up and he said, I will fight this giant, this warrior, this champion in the flesh. I will fight this enemy that's posing this threat upon the children of Israel. Saul questioned amongst his men. And then he said, okay. He took his armor and then placed it on David. It says here, then Saul dressed David in his own tunic. He put a coat of armor on him and a bronze helmet on his head. David fastened on his sword over the tunic and tried walking because he was not used to them. I cannot go in these, he said to Saul, because I am not used to them. So he took them off. I can't wear your armor, it doesn't fit me. My prayer life maybe is different from yours. I might wake up early in the morning and pray. You might jog and pray. You might ride and drive in your car and pray. You might spend a certain time to read the Word of God. Each one of us have a different relationship with Christ, to our commander, to our leader. But we have to make it personal. The belt, this belt, this truth has to fit for me. I have to receive the Word for me. Because in time of a challenge, I have to be ready. David say, I can't wear your gear, Saul. Saul, if you read the scriptures and understand Saul, he was a tall guy. David, on the other hand, was a short guy. But however, the armor still exists. I'm not throwing away the word, but I'm just telling you that the armor did not fit. But David looked at it and said, listen, Saul, I cannot walk around. I cannot do anything. Let me put this off. Saul and the rest of the men saw it as a flesh thing. David, if you read on to the scripture, we'll come to realize David stood there in what he already came there to fight with. But he took his slingshot and his rock that he found, and he knocked out the giant. And then he dismantled him. I can say it like that. So here is a child of God that was anointed to call. Many of you have giants in your life. Sometimes certain things that people want to give you and tell you, but you have to have that relationship with Christ. And when you have that relationship with Christ, my God, when your giant is a financial burden, when your giant is cancer, when your giant is your kids or not, your giant is your marriage, your giant is a job, no matter what it is, your personal relationship with Christ changes things. I am following my leader in Christ. I have established a truth with him because of the fact that he is the true foundation of my heart. I understand why I'm in this battle. I understand the purpose of the truth, of the belt of the truth. I'm surrounded it and I'm connecting it. And now I understand that this belt fit is going to securely hold my armor in place. I thank God for what you're trying to tell me. I thank God for what you're trying to present to me. But I want to spend my time with the Lord. I'm going to go doing this 21 days of prayer. If possible, we're encouraging you to also fast. If you continue, like I said, to get the material that we offer, it teaches you about fasting. But just be consistent in your prayer. That's good also. We encourage you. Come together corporately to pray as we all pray for healing our land. The latter thing is surrounded by the truth. And this particular area is that the belt surrounds the entire waist area. We understand from the beginning, like I said, is that the belt protects us, all right, from the lower portion. They could take the tunic and flip it over and give you more room there. It's a perfect fit. But now we're talking about surrounded by the truth. 1 Kings 6:15, if you have it, it says, when the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Oh, no, my Lord. What shall we do? The servant asked. Don't be afraid. The prophet answered. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And Elias prayed, open up his eyes, Lord, so that he may see them, the Lord. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he took and saw the hills full of the horses and the chariots of fire around Elias. As stated before, the belt surrounds us, the entire armor. The prophet was surrounded by an army coming against him. The servant was terrified. They come to get us. I don't know what was the end result if they would have got him, but here's the thing. The prophet said, you don't see what I see. See, I had already established a personal relationship because it's fitted for me. Now, what seems to be surrounded, what seems to be problems and issues, what seems to be like things are caving on me. Oh no, I need for you to open up your eyes. I need you to really see what I see. See, if you take it back from the very beginning, this is not a fleshly battle. This is a spiritual warfare. And what the enemy has surrounded, my God, is surrounding them. See, the prophet Elijah's had to turn around and say, let me just, Lord, I pray that I could touch his eyes that he can see what I can see. See, when you are in battle, sometimes you got to understand that the people around you have to see what you see. They got to see the vision. You got to see the hard thing. It's situation at times where people, if a person don't want to pray and they want to talk, set them aside. This is war. You have to hook up. You have to find yourself surrounded by people of like-minded that have a heart to pray even fast, but focus on breakthroughs. It's victory here. There are so many people that's dealing with mental health. There's people dealing with cancer. There's people still dealing with the young girls are still in sex slaves. But yet and still, the whole world is talking about the coronavirus. No. We're still praying and we're still connecting. We're still surrounding. It seems like their issues are just tossed aside. No, we're here to encourage you. We're still praying for you. The prophet saw something different. When you're in prayer, when you're exposed to the truth, when you read the scripture and it opens your eyes, my God, because the flesh had just pushed off and now the spirit just came through. I can read the scripture with a different lens. I understand it. I see it. I can see the strategy of the enemy, but he does not see the strategy of God. And in a lot of verses, it says in Mark, the second chapter, I love this as a latter verse because of the fact that when I look at this particular scripture or story, it's still emphasizing surrounded by the truth. Mark, the second chapter, verses 3-5, it say, some men came, bring to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowering the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Surrounded by men and women of God. I love this story because of the fact that we see Jesus in the house. He's in the center of this house. They was bringing before him many that are sick, that need healing and deliverance. There was a crowd of people coming into this house. But these four individuals, whether it was their friend or whether it was a relative, they brung their loved one to Christ. Got together and we brung this person to the truth. They did not allow the circumstances to stop them from bringing someone to the truth. They climbed the roof. They moved away the roof covering, put a hole in the roof, lift up their family member or their friend and lower him before Jesus. And it was because of the fact those four, their faith, the Bible say that Jesus healed this individual. Man, how wonderful it is that we have men and women of God that's out there, that's watching this video, that's understanding the belt of truth. There's so many people there surround us, but yet and still, sometimes we allow the circumstances of the coronavirus to stop us from reaching out. How many opportunities that we have the chance to pick up a phone and call somebody? And call another person, but keep it focused on the word of God. Just to show you love, just to call somebody that you haven't called in years and ask for forgiveness. Clear up certain things because you never know the situation of the person because they might be the paralyzed person. You and your family members or another person from church or somebody can come around and support. Oh, the opportunity to go buy groceries for our friends and family, to just reach out and do something wonderful, surprise them. They want to know, just a gesture of love, surrounded by men and women. Because in any battle, You might be the arrow person. I might be the person with the swords. Another person might be utilizing the cannon. However it is, we're on the same team. One body. We're surrounded together. In other words, that belt surrounded everything, the whole armor fitted together to support the mission of our leader. And that's what it's all come about. I'm encouraging you through the belt of the truth that you take this opportunity to share and to find somebody. Go through your phone, pray on it, ask and say, Lord, show me somebody that I can minister the word of God, that I can reach, that I can bring them to the truth. And I pray that each and every day during these 21 days of prayer and fasting, or 21 days of prayer, that you get an opportunity to do that. Sometimes you might not be able to actually see them, but technology has given us Zoom and Teams. No matter how you do it, just like they did, they went up on the roof. They did not allow the circumstances to hold them down. Some of us have lost jobs. Some of us have, our hours have been cut. Some of us are dealing with uncertainty. But do not allow your joy to be taken in this battle. Fight back. Find yourself hooking up with spiritual individuals that are focused to do and win the gospel for those that's out there. Listen, I want to pray for you, for those that's hurting, those that are dealing with situations, those that are facing a battle right now. So I want to pray with you and ask that if you pray this prayer with me, for those that don't know Christ, I want you to be able to be a part of this winning team, because the truth is, Christ, we are victorious through Christ's life. Let us pray. Well, gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we give honor and glory to you for that which you have blessed us with. And we thank you for this first part of the series, and we continue to ask that you bless each and every speaker that come forth. We thank you for these 21 days of prayer, that you will open up the minds and the hearts of so many. And that on the latter portion of these 21 days, Lord, that each portion that we can give a report, a testimony of what you have done in our lives, how we have helped and talked to each other, how we encourage, and we've been a spiritual gift. Maybe we give some money or food or whatever it might be, Lord. But there are some that's out there that are lost and they're watching. And I want to make a prayer for them. I pray that they will begin to open up their mouth and believe in their heart that Jesus, you are the Lord. You are the King, their salvation. You're the direction. You're the one that's leading them in battle. And that they should never have to worry anymore. I pray for their sleep to be at peace. I pray when they wake up, they will have joy. And I pray for their whole house to be saved. And Father, we ask that you continue to pray for those that's in the hospital with this pandemic, but more importantly, those that are still facing other disease and other situations. In the days and the weeks and the months to come, Lord, I pray that the solution will come and that to our leaders, that our land will be blessed and be healed. I claim victory and I touch and agree, and I join myself truthfully with the body of Christ. And we come to you, thank you for all the blessing. We speak it in existence that it would happen. And we pray for those that are seeking a new life, a new direction, and be a part of God's army. We thank you for this. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, we're just going to ask you to text the word forgive to 954-951-4747. The church is going to be able to send you a free digital resource to help you in your new relationship with Christ. And definitely, we have a 1-844 prayer line that's always available for you 24 hours a day. That's going to be 844-680-7727. 844-680-PRAY. The last four digits, 7727, spells I pray. I pray for you. I will continue to thank God for you when the day comes that we can come back into the household of God. Make sure you come through on a Sunday, 21 days of prayer. Get your material. We got an awesome series. You're going to hear some of the other speakers come from. Come and speak. Let somebody know. Thank you. Have a blessed week. In Jesus' name, amen.